I can see that a lot of confusion with the, related to the rotating motion. But I don't know what to say. you have to think about a lot. Yeah? So for example, that the pendulum, yes, pendulum. For example, this pendulum, just single pendulum, it rotates, it moves, if I let it move, it swing like this. Right? Say that you attach the gyro, a rate gyro, to measure the angular velocity. If you attach it here, you should get theta 1 dot, if the gyro works correctly. Right? But still, if you attach here, it moves huge distance compared to this, but you should get exactly same angular velocity, theta dot. So any point, angular velocity is theta 1 dot. Okay? It doesn't matter where you put your gyro. As long as the axis, the sensing axis is the same, you always measure the same angular velocity. Okay, where are we? Ah. So, this Newton's second law for planar motion, rotating planar motion, is I omega dot. But some of moment part is, as I said before, I said that this is r cross f. But there will be some different kind of moment could be generated. For example, say that again pendulum. Here, and you say that you apply force here, F. Obviously, because you apply force this way, then obviously it rotates this way, right? And in this case, R is the vector starting from the point where you are concerning about the rotation to the where the force is applied. So this is the R vector. If you R cross F, you got exactly the moment that generated by this force. You can see immediately how this cross product will work. Because if you apply force this way, parallel to the R, then R cross F is a two parallel vector cross product is zero. Right? Physically, this force, if you're pulling this way, you cannot rotate. This pendulum doesn't rotate if you apply force this way. So that you can see how this cross product will work to find out this moment. On the other hand, there are different kind of moment that which this moment is generated by force with the distance, but some moment is generated directly. Say that, let's say I attach here to the axle some electrical motor. The electrical motor will generate the rotating torque directly. Of course, inside the mechanism, there will be some, this R cross F will work, but you can interpret that this electrical motor generate the torque directly. The one that most of you already seen the third problem in the tutorial session, problem set number 3 again, and this there's this vertical bar here, and then there's some moment applied here and force applied here. Then some of moment means that you adding this, and then moment generated is by force as well. Okay. If you're considering the motion at this axis rotation. But if calculate the moment at this tip, then R is zero, therefore there's no moment by this force. But still, this moment still applies at any point here. Okay, that's the one fact that you have to consider. Unlike the sum of force in the linear motion, there's only force in the linear motion, but in moment, there's two different ways of generating the moment. Direct moment and moment with this distance R. We call it moment arm. So moment arm cross product with force. So two different ways. Okay, let me give you an example. Always example gives you better idea. Although I derived this equation for rigid body, but I can use this equation for the particle system as well. Let me use this to the particle system. So here's the pendulum, but the particle pendulum. There's no mass in this rod. The rod mass is negligible. At the end, I have a concentrated particle mass, say 2 kilograms. And this rod is extended. It's not double joint. It's only one joint, but it's extended. There's another particle here, which mass is 3 kilograms. Angle for both, because this rod is rigid, so this angle is always same angle, theta. And gravitational force, there's a gravitational force here, this way, 2g, here's gravitational force, 3g. Let's calculate let's drive the equation of motion using this equation. You can, of course, drive the exactly same equation using the equation that we used to use for this particle dynamics. Sum of forces m times acceleration. You can use this that equation as well. But here, I'm going to use this rotating dynamics. First, let's calculate the sum of moment part. Of course, the origin, rotating origin that I'm concerning here is this point, O. Let's call this as O. So sum of moment at O would be R cross to the first force. This is the R vector. Let's call this is 1 meter. Another one, this is also 1 meter. Okay. Somehow I put the how do I call it? Let's say this direction, parallel with the extended line of the straight line. Let's call that is the general direction. I would say so general. Let's call unit vector towards in this direction is E. Then first R vector from here to the first mass is 1 E, right? And second moment arm is 1 meter plus 1 meter, 2E, right? So this is R1 cross product 2G. I don't know what this direction would be. Let's call this is E1, this direction. The downwards is, let's call it, unit vector is E2 direction. Then I can write down this E2G, oh, this is 2, yes, 2G. 2G, E2 hat, plus another cross product to the third second mass R2 cross product 3GE2 and R1 I can replace by R1 was 1 meter E1 direction cross product 2G E2 direction R2 is 2E1 cross product 2G E2 direction. I can take out all this constant outside, so this is 2G E1 cross E2. This is 4G E1 cross E2. So I have to figure out what's the cross product of E1 and E2 would be. Oh, something's wrong?
That'll be 6G.
Oh, yes, this, oh, this should be 3. This is 6, yes. Good, thank you. Last week and this week, I made a lot of mistakes in the class. Not only this class, but in the other class as well. Okay, so now I have to figure out what this cross product could be. So I'm going to use the, up to now that in the class, I used two different ways of doing cross product. For this, I'm going to use the other one, but I haven't used it. So which was, cross product of two vectors is the magnitude of each vector. And the multiply the sine of angle between E1 and E2. What's the angle between them? This is theta. So their angle between them is sine theta. And then, using your cross product rule, E1 is that way, E2 is down way, so I have to use this way and then it's going in, right? Obviously, I mean, force is acting this way, so this one will rotate this way. So that's the cross product direction going in, going into this space. So because E1 is that way, E2 is downwards, so E1 cross E2, and your thumb is going in. So this is the clockwise rotation. So let's this clockwise rotation inside, let's call that is our E3 vector going in. Going in, we usually use this symbol. This symbol means that your vector is going in. If you want to express the to going out, this is the expression to, this means vector is going out, coming out from the plane. Why use this logic? Is because you can imagine the arrow. It's coming in this way. If you're looking at from here, it looks like this. If you're looking at from there, it looks like hopefully that. Yeah. So I think that's the logic for this symbol. So E3 is going in. So this is the direction E3. And 6G. And same thing. Same thing happens here and E3. But I know that the magnitude of E1 is 1. Because I define the E1 and E2 is a unit vector. This is 1. So this is same thing, 2G sine theta E3 plus 6G sine theta E3. Same direction, therefore I can sum up 8G sine theta E3. But I didn't mention the direction, but we usually define the okay, let's define in this way. So let's say define the this direction is positive. Okay, so what does that mean is that let's leave it. I would confuse it later, but okay, let's define the distraction is positive. Should I do that? No, I shouldn't. I should define counterclockwise is positive. Because I draw this diagram, whenever you draw this kind of diagram, you always move to the positive direction. Otherwise, all signs are messed up. So I draw it this way, clockwise. So clockwise is positive. So this means that this moment generates the counterclockwise. Therefore, in terms of sign, I can write down this way was positive, but I got this term as a counterclockwise, therefore I put the minus sign, because E3 is the negative direction. So this is the expression for the sum of moment. What about the left-hand side of the equation was I times omega dot. Omega dot, omega is theta dot, therefore omega dot is theta double dot. I was integration of r square dm. Right? But we have two concentrated mass. So it's not integral, it's just a summation. So first mass was r1 square times 2 kilogram plus second mass is r2 square plus 3 kilogram. Theta double dot. R1 was 1, R2 was 2, 2 square is 4, this is 12, this is 2, so I got 14 theta double dot. And this are equal, therefore theta double dot is equal to minus 4 over 7 sine theta. So this is your equation of motion. Yep. So, any question? Yeah. That's it. But, any question? But what if let's imagine the different example. This is particle example. But let's say actual rigid body example. Say that helicopter blade. Okay, looking at from the top. So this is the helicopter blade, simplified one, just this, and at the center, the engine will rotate this with the moment M, right? Then equation of motion is moment I times omega dot. That's it. But what about the eye? What's the eye look like? So I should be, let's say this is my origin, O, and the x-axis is defined in this way. Then if you consider the very small segment of this helicopter blade, let's call this mass dm, then you have to integrate this x square. I consider this is very thin line, so I ignore the y coordinates. R square becomes x square dm by whole mass m. Also, let's call this whole length is L, so this is half L of 2. I put the O at the center of this blade. Dm can be, I can write down this differently. Let's, if you're looking at from here, cross-section area, let's call it A. Yeah? If you're looking at from this beam, from this direction. And this small mass dm has the length dx, right? Then dx times, A times dx is the volume of that small segment. And if I multiply rho, which is the density of this material, then this is the mass of dm. Then I can replace dm by x square a rho dx. And now the integration variable becomes from m to x, so I replace the integration interval from m to x. X should be minus L to L over 2 to plus L over 2. Right? Rho and cross-section area, let's assume that that's constant throughout this x coordinates. And the density is also constant, uniform material. Then you can take out A and rho outside. They are constant. So I can take out A and rho outside. And it's the integral of x squared dx from minus L over 2 to L over 2. So x squared is actually symmetric about this origin. So I can just integrate from 0 to L over 2 and multiply 2 times. Then this becomes 2a times rho x cubed over 3. And replaced by L over 2 and 0. And you got 2a rho. L over 2 cubed is L cubed over 4, 8 times 3, 24. And 2, 24 becomes 12. And this is the rho a L cubed divided by 12, but rho a times L square, I can write down this way. Rho a is total, a times L is total volume of whole blade multiplied by density is total mass. So this becomes m L square divided by 12. Okay, so I just plug in this to the equation of motion. M is ML square divided by 12 theta double dot. So this is your equation of motion. I don't expect you to calculate this for very complicated shape, but I expect you to do this for simple shape. So this was, we calculate the moment of inertia at the center of this blade. What if calculating different point? Say that it's now, it's not the helicopter blade, but this is now robot arm. But same length. But now electrical motor is attached to move this robot arm, attached here at the tip of the stick. Then let's calculate the let's drive the equation of motion for here. So this is a different origin of prime. So x is defined from here and all the way up to distance L. Equation is moment of equation is same. M is of course applies some moment here. I times theta double dot. But now I is distance measured from this point, not the center. So this is integration x square dm m. Use the exactly same logic. You replace dm by rho times dx a. That this becomes x square dm a times rho times dx. This is now integration from 0 to L. A rho going outside. Integration of x square is again x cubed over 3. L over 0. This is rho A rho L cubed over 3. Again, A rho L can be replaced by total mass M. This becomes ML square over 3. So if same mass, same length, then moment of inertia, let me write down equation finally. M is ML square over 3, theta double dot. This is the equation for that. So if the same stick, same length, same total mass, but one thing is you try to rotate from at the tip. The other one is you try to rotate at the center. Only difference is the moment of inertia, inertia difference. This is the 4 times smaller. This value is 4 times smaller. Because previous one was ml square over 3. This is 4 times smaller. Therefore, if it's a long stick, try to rotate at the center. It's much easier to try to rotate at the tip. Because it's a longer stick at the tip, it's much harder to rotate. Because the inertia, the mass property, this moment of inertia is much, much larger. Okay. Later, I'll show you that this angular momentum is also similar to the linear motion. This momentum is preserved if there's no external force. Right? The thing is that this is done by the figure skating athletics. When they rotate, they initially apply some kind of torque, and then they rotate over the ice. Then you can assume that there's almost no friction, so no force, no torque. But they just rotate with the initial torque, so that momentum will be preserved. But while they're rotating, if they stretch the arm, then this R, when you calculate the moment of inertia, R square is getting bigger and bigger, so your moment of inertia is getting bigger. But the angular momentum should be preserved, I times omega should be preserved. I getting bigger, then omega getting smaller. So that I times omega is constant. That's why if you stretch the arm, rotating velocity is decreased. And then if you retreat the arm, rotating velocity is getting faster. Okay. Any questions so far? No? Okay. This, now, let's look at this two moment of inertia. I'm looking at only moment of inertia, this long stick. One is calculated at the center. Let's call it G now instead of O. And here's another one calculated here, O. And this one, let's call it IG, was ML squared divided by 12. If I calculate the moment of inertia at O, IO, we just calculate ML squared over 3. The question is that, is there any relation between these two? Answer is yes. It's like this. IO, I can write down ML squared 12, ML squared over, how much should I put? So that becomes 3. 3, right? Right? Then this two sum is 4 over 12. 4 over 12 is this 3? Yes. So, 4, 12, yes? Yeah, correct? Something is strange. Yes, I think that's right. Yeah, I was, but I'm confusing myself. that's true. 12, 4, 3, Chang. 3. 3, yes. Is it 4? No, I add up here, then I got 4. Okay. Okay, so I think this way is multiply 4. Yes? Happy? Yeah? Yes. I'm doing the simple thing very complicated way. Okay. So this is 3 is cancelled. I now know this is IG. Moment of inertia at the center plus M times L squared divided by 4. Right? This is IG plus M times L over 2 squared. This is IG plus total mass times distance from O to G squared. So moment of inertia at other than the mass center, if you know the moment of inertia at center, mass center, then you just add the moment of inertia at the center plus total mass times the distance that you are away from the mass center. Then that's the moment of inertia at that point. Let me draw this way. So this is some object. This is the mass center. Mass center means that if you integrate distance from any point from G, let's call this R, throughout the whole mass, then this should be zero. Then that's the definition of mass center. If you know the moment of inertia at mass center, then if you pick any point, any other point, if this distance between them, I use R too many times, but R, then the moment of inertia at O is IG plus total mass times R squared. Let me distinguish this R, O, and G. So R, O, G. This is has a special name. This is called parallel axis theorem. This even works for the three-dimensional case. There's only two things are called theorem in this whole class. One is parallel axis theorem, the other one is transport theorem. The reason that I'm mentioning is that these two are very important. Okay. Should I have a time. I have a time, so. Oh, yes, so in the last, after the last class, a lot of you asked me that whether you should know how to derive this whole transport theorem. Yes, but if you want to be a minimalist, then you just remember the theorem. But the importance of derivation, understanding derivation, is you could gain more insight, more deeper understanding. So when you end up deriving some equation, dynamics equation for the actual problem you will meet in the later, without this deeper understanding, only memorizing the result, it could cause you some problem. You might get confused. So, but bottom line is that in the exam, I don't ask to derive the whole transport theorem. Okay, I think I stop here. You already got saturated. I see you in the next week.